Thank you. The audiovisual expert went to get me a glass of water, so I'm not sure everything is working. I'm going to speak very fast. I'm going to try and include a lot of different topics. I know that some students have to leave right at 1:20, so I'll finish just before then, but then we have another half hour after that for questions. So I used to work on Wall Street. I managed money for billionaires, and I started reading books about the environment and the end of nature and about energy. And in 2003, I gave all my clients their money back, and I quit, and I started to study the human ecosystem full time, all the aspects that comprise the human ecosystem, money, ecology, environment, energy. Spent a lot of time on human behavior. And in my opinion, unless you integrate all these things, you don't have a coherent view of our predicament. And I'm going to go very fast through many of these. I'm going to give short shrift to human behavior, but tonight I'm speaking at a degrowth event that Justin set up, and I'll be spending a lot more time on that. Kind of like when you go to high school and the magician comes to school and then advertises the thing at nighttime. So here's the overview of my talk, energy, money, human behavior, environment. I'm going to have a synthesis about, thanks Bonnie, about where we're at, and then a small advice on, as professors or students, some questions to think about and what to do. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on what I'm doing or what personally we can do, but that's going to be more in the talk tonight. Okay, first, energy. So many of you are studying in a natural resources school, so you understand the trophic pyramid of nature. There's an energy input at every stage, and there's waste heat at every stage of the trophic pyramid. But at every stage, there is energy. Energy underpins everything. And this is not only true in nature, but it's true in human systems. Our economy is largely based on sunlight, but sunlight from different eras. We have ancient sunlight in the form of coal, oil, natural gas. We have old sunlight in the form of trees and timber. Then we have current sunlight, which is crops and such, agriculture, animals. So that energy combines into our economies and increases wages, profits, reduces the price of goods, and increases the number of people. Actually, it's kind of an eerie thought, but 50% of the protein in our bodies and 80% of the nitrogen is directly from natural gas via the Haber-Bosch process of fertilizing our plants. So fossil fuels actually are part of us. But how does oil, how does energy subsidize all these things? We need energy no matter what we make, goods and services in our economy. There is always, always, always an energy conversion, always an energy input. No matter how you make a cup, whether it's with coconut or ceramic or with glass or with tin, you always first need energy in order to accomplish that. So this is a graph showing the correlation between growth or gross domestic product and energy. The GDP is the red line, and the more useful energy, the transportation or electricity, the higher the correlation between energy and growth is. You might say, well, which causes which, and it really doesn't matter, because if we think of a factory and we want to create one more unit of whatever it's producing, that unit will require energy. Energy and growth are completely correlated. So this is a 200-year history of global energy use. This pink sliver is biomass, largely trees. I got my PhD in Vermont, and in the 1850s in Vermont, on the east coast of the United States, it was completely clear-cut. They had used all the trees for fuel and timber. Then the gray bar is coal, and then we found oil and natural gas, and the light blue is nuclear, and the dark blue is hydro. And then the little slivers of yellow are renewables on top. But wait, oil and energy is just a substitutable input. That's what most economists think. I didn't know of any Canadian economists, so I just put your Mr. Harper. But is he an economist? Oh, okay, good, then perfect. Paul Krugman is an economist, and he just had a piece last week in the New York Times saying energy's not special,
It's just an input. It's substitutable. That is one of the major flaws in macroeconomics. Everything on this chart, it costs around $90. Tequila, coffee machine, sushi, some boots, $100 bill, glasses, and oil. But why is oil special? One barrel of oil has 5.7 million BTUs of energy potential in it. How much is that? Well, that's 1,700 kilowatt hours of energy work potential. How much is that? Every one of us doing manual labor, digging ditches or pulling wheelbarrow loads or shoveling snow, does 6/10 of a kilowatt hour of work in one day. So one barrel of oil for $100 substitutes 11 years of me working. The average American salary, I don't know about Canada, is $44,000 a year. So one barrel of oil that is 200 million year old ancient sunlight gives us $500,000 worth of substitute for human benefits. Okay, but a macroeconomist would say, this is just the Cobb-Douglas function, that our wealth is based on capital and productivity. Well, both capital and labor are actually dependent variables on energy. Energy is king in our economies. This is me. I'm 1/10 of a horse, maybe a little bit, maybe 1/9 right now. This is my horse, which is one horse. This is my utility vehicle, 45 horsepower. This is 150 horse, my truck, which if I put this amount of gasoline in, I could push a whole load of things about 8 miles for this much, well, maybe 6 miles. But we, each human, has the energy metabolism of a 30-ton primate. The average American, and Canadians are slightly more, uses 60 barrel of oil equivalents of oil, coal, and natural gas every day standing behind us. These are fossil slaves propel our economies. And the metabolism of these fossil slaves, we basically have hundreds of fossil slaves standing behind us that we don't even think about. But now, given that you're in environmental school, we're realizing that they don't complain, they don't talk, but that they poop and they breathe, which I'm going to talk about later. Okay, so the major theme of industrialization is what we did is we replaced tasks that humans used to do by themselves with large amounts of fossil energy. Think about driving a car. That uses between 200 and 400 units of energy for every human unit before. So we use a lot of energy and we get to where we're going 10 times faster. So where I live in Wisconsin, there's milking, cow milking. So manually it takes 30 minutes a day to milk a cow, per cow. So the wage of that ends up being $3 an hour. You can have a semi-automated milking machine where you add 300 kilowatts of kilowatt hours of energy per cow. It reduces the human time down to 15 minutes a cow, and it raises the wages to $5 an hour. Or the fully automated machine where you're adding a lot of energy per cow, 700 kilowatt hours, only 3 minutes per human, but your wage goes up $15 an hour. Or your profits go up, or the price of milk goes down, or some combination of that. This is a story of what's happened in our industrialized world. Here's a little bit, first before I get to another example. So a human in the United States, it costs $260 for someone to do 1 kilowatt hour of work. Whereas these are the prices of what the various fossil fuels are per kilowatt hour of work. So one unit of this fuel at these various prices is this many energy slaves that it supplants. And this is per the average human, because the United States is very energy intensive. I'm going to come back to this. But imagine that you have a lumberjack who chops down trees. He makes $5 an hour. He's going to bring the trees to sell for firewood. And then he finds a buddy, and the two of them can make $15 an hour because they can carry heavier trees. They divide it by two, and they get $7.50 an hour. But then imagine all the energy that it would take to build a road. And all of a sudden, the road allows them to move things very much easier to where they need to sell them. There's 50 units of fossil energy now, and the wage goes up to $15. And then they add chainsaws to it. So now we're using 100 units of mechanized fossil energy, and the wage goes up to $25 an hour. And then we add these machines that can chop the trees down and move them. And now we're adding a lot more mechanical energy, but still only the energy of one or two humans. And our wages are going up to $40 an hour. And then we add the trucks to transport everything. And at each level, there's more and more energy units being added, only for one or two humans. And the wages go very high. But what happens is we have such an immense infrastructure that requires energy that when gasoline goes from $2 to $4 a gallon, the benefits drop. Still, the blue is still much, much higher than it used to be, but it crimps the benefits because we have so much energy use. And then if gasoline goes from $4 to $6, something interesting happens. The benefits go down even more, and the really energy-intensive processes are actually now less profitable than the moderately energy-intensive processes. And this is what's happening in the world right now. Because we, 30, 40 years ago, 90% of the food in Vancouver was grown within 100 miles of here. And now we average 1,300, 1,400 miles of supply chain to get the food here. We've built an enormous interconnected global heat engine of commerce and long supply chains. So there's another aspect to this that if fossil labor is so undervalued, the implication of that then is that human labor is overvalued. And this ends up being a 200-year chart of wages in the United States. Wages peaked in the mid-1970s, real wages, and productivity kept going higher. That's because the owners of capital ended up choosing these cheap fossil slaves instead of using actually human laborers. This is a whole other topic, but I just wanted to point that out. So what about technology? How does technology, most narratives are that technology drives our societies. Well, most technology is just a vector for more energy use. Most things we use technology for are just things that replace what humans used to do themselves, like a weed eater or a chainsaw or driving a car we used to walk. There's also been new resource conversions where we develop Facebook or things that humans didn't used to have or jet airplanes. We can also have technology would make us use our energy better, like in a power plant or efficient house or things like that. And then finally, we use technology to invent new energy sources, like solar panels or new ways to drill for oil. So these are the four ways we use technology, but these two first ways dominate in their impact on human societies. In other words, most technology just ends up being a vector for more energy use. Well, the common narrative now in the America, I don't know about Canada, is that look at all this energy we're finding in the tar sands and in the Bakken Shale in North Dakota, et cetera. Well, in nature, there's an energy relationship between predator and prey that's called optimal foraging theory, that an animal expends energy in order to get energy. And that ratio, the higher that ratio is, the more extra surplus energy the organism has for mating, reproduction, cellular maintenance, et cetera. And if a cheetah chased mice all day, it might be very successful, but the energy payoff in the mouse would be too small to keep his life going. The same thing in the human sphere is it takes energy to get energy. In the 1930s, we would spend one barrel of energy and we would get 100 barrels out of the ground in return. By the 1970s, we would get 30 back because we had to drill so much deeper. By the year 2000, we were only getting around 10 to 1 back. So energy has costs in biophysical terms, in energy and natural resource terms, not only dollars. This is just three of the largest oil companies in the world. The orange lines are showing how much their capital expenditures to find and develop oil is, and the blue line is how much their production is. Okay, so yes. There is a conflation, a confusion between energy reserves and energy resources. We will never run out of oil. There are trillions of barrels of oil all around the world under the ground, but the cost, the same as a lion looking at a herd of buffalo, it's the energy payoff that's difficult. This yellow line here represents the average extraction break-even cost for the oil majors over the last 15 years. And
The year 2000,
it cost oil companies $9 to get oil out of the ground. They're break even. The energy majors now in 2014 are $120, including CapEx and dividends. So the oil extraction costs, it's getting more and more costly. Okay, moving into economics. How much time did that take? Is 10-2? All right, I'll go fast. So what is money? Well, money, once I just told you that energy is the fundamental underpinning of our civilization, money is a claim on energy. Money is a claim on future energy. If you have money in your pocket, you're probably going to go spend it tonight on something, but you could save it for 10 years. And whenever you spend it, it's a call on energy and natural resources. Our real capital, money and financial capital, is just a marker for real capital. That's my backyard, natural capital, as you all know here, trees and healthy ecosystems and soil and river. Social capital, which is our friends and our networks and our family, in this case, my dogs. This is my house, built capital. There's chainsaws and a grill and an aloe vera plant and solar panels. We use energy and money to convert primary capital into stuff that we need. And then there's human capital, which is our skills and our knowledge and our health and our ability to identify edible mushrooms. And that's my dad, and he's a doctor and such. So the history of humanity is developing, taking ecosystem service and flows, combining with natural capital to generate surplus. And before we were hunter-gatherers, we would have not a lot of surplus because we didn't carry it around with us. And then we had surplus in agriculture. And now we focus not on surplus, but on surplus value. We optimize stocks and bonds and things that are representing the surplus. But where does money fit in? Money is actually critical. Most people don't understand this because it's not taught right in economics. Economics treats that banks are intermediaries. If you, I just picked you at random, want to develop a car wash in Vancouver and you go to the bank and you have good credit and they say, we'll give you $100,000. At that moment, two things happen. She gets $100,000 cash in her account, and the bank gets $100,000 IOU from her on their account. So that is all well understood. What's not understood is at that moment in time, $100,000 of purchasing power goes into her account, and nowhere else in the world did it leave. So at that moment, there was $100,000 more claims on energy and resources and stuff than there was a minute before. And this worked for 80 or 90 years because we lived on an empty planet, and there were all kinds of opportunities and technologies and open space. But now we're on a full planet. The resource problems are getting more severe. Every year since I've been on the planet, the United States, Canada is slightly different, but all countries are roughly the same in this regard, created more debt than they created GDP. Debt has grown, the red line, much, much faster than GDP. And there's something called debt productivity, which is how much GDP we get for each additional dollar of debt. And that's a trend of the last 40 years. And once we get anything below 1-to-1 is unsustainable. Once we get to zero, that means we're just transmuting wealth into income. We're using our wealth as income instead of as investments. And this is a problem because at some point in the past, which I would guess is in the 1970s, we passed a point where there was too much money, monetary claims on the underlying energy and natural resource assets. I'm gonna skip that for time constraint reasons. Okay, I'm not gonna do this justice because it really needs a half hour, but I'm gonna do it in 10 minutes. Human behavior is the major driver of our predicament. Yes, we have an energy problem. Yes, we have an environmental problem. Yes, we have an economic problem. All of this comes back to this. And we evolved from organisms that evolved in periods, long, long periods of privation and scarcity. And so our behavior is shaped through evolutionary time. We have basic three areas of the brain that have built on top of each other and forward. The reptilian brain, which is the fight or flight reflexes, the the limbic system, which is our emotions, and then the neomammalian neocortex, which is when we think about our exams are due and our mortgage payments, and we think like that. But they're all kind of acting together. That was an example. You knew that Justin wasn't going to invite some psycho here to talk, probably not. But that was an example of your reptilian system taking over just automatically. And so our brains work with all three of these things going on, and when they work in synergy, we can accomplish amazing things. So we evolved from apes, not the apes that are alive today, but apes that were alive 6 or 7 million years ago. We share 98.9% of our DNA with chimps. We share 90% of our DNA with cows, 80% with cats, 70% with mice, 60% with fruit flies, 50% with bananas. We're related to everything on the earth. It turns out, well, I'm going to skip that. If you want to learn more about that, come tonight. But we and our behaviors are driven by what has happened in evolutionary time. And what are some of those behaviors? Well, one thing is that we really, really focus on the present rather than the future. And given climate change and peak oil and some of these long-term concerns, you can understand why this might be. Scientists have shown that there's a reasonable chance that we're impacting the biosphere. Actually, they're pretty sure that the carbon that we're emitting is impacting things and we need to stop. Actually, they're 95% confident that humans are the main drivers of climate change, and we better do something about it. We're running out of time, and there's not much that we can do. Hey, you know what? Are you scared about that? No, let's just go get something to eat. Holy crap, Godzilla is in Vancouver. It's like we don't pay attention to a danger until it's right in front of our face. And that is an evolutionary hangover from reacting to saber-toothed tigers and things like that. The type of things that you all are studying here about the long-term future are interesting to our neocortex, but they don't motivate our behavior because they're so long in the future. Okay, status is very prominent in our societies. It's prominent in nature, sexual selection, and competing for resources, competing for mates. Every year there's a new yacht that gets built by some billionaire that's 1 or 2 feet longer than the yacht of the record the year before, and et cetera. There's studies showing that you would much rather make $60,000 a year in salary if all of your friends were making $50,000 than you would making $80,000 if all of your friends were making $100,000. We very, very much care about relative performance in all aspects of life more than absolute. So there's something else called supernormal stimuli. In the field of human ethology, they can paint a fake popsicle with a red large bird beak, and the mama bird will repeatedly feed that bird more than the real birds that are hungry and crying next to it, because it's like a very intense evolutionary signal that is hijacked in that situation. Well, we have the same sort of intense evolutionary signals that are hijacking our concentration in our activities, and you can just, these are like high school students going on to work or to school, you know, looking at their Facebook and Twitter, et cetera. So the problem is that the area, the things that are very short-term appealing shout loudest to us, and the things that really deserve our concern, the long-term environmental issues, are they don't shout that loud. Another aspect of human behavior is that we are overly optimistic and we self-deceive. And 95% of college professors think they're better than average. Optimism is actually very healthy for your body because it reduces the secretion of cortisol, which is a stress hormone. It boosts your immune system, et cetera. So we like to think that things are better. But there's all sorts of cognitive biases that are present, and I don't have time to talk about them now. But I believe that humans are delusional. I think we, things like love and lust and greed are shout really loudly, and you know, energy or a dolphin or things in the future are not so loud. They're not real. And before you think I'm being pejorative to everyone, I too am delusional. I mean, I've known a lot of times what I was really believed in something, and then it turns out I was wrong. But we go through life being deluded about a lot of things. One aspect of human behavior, which is very relevant, is our ancestral group selection hangover to really prefer an in-group and really ostracize an out-group. And I think with the economic challenges we're facing now, is it's natural for us to blame the Muslims or the Democrats or the Republicans or the Chinese or the tree huggers or the rich or the poor. We blame someone for what's happening, when in reality, it's our fossil slaves have been asking for pay raises. And the way that that ripples through our economies and it makes things a little less easy, and it's happening in slow motion, but that's the real villain here, but we blame other people. And then status, getting back to that, there's a limit to how much you can say about the things that I'm saying, or you know in your own social circles. How many of you would willingly do something that would reduce your social status amongst your friends and amongst strangers? We don't do that. We only say and do things that are in the fairway of acceptable political correctness. When we're talking about the things I'm talking about, that's difficult. Here's one interesting good thing that I did a paper on, that the more energy we use, I wanted to see how correlated that was with how much very happiness we were in a sociological study. So this is the more energy used, this is the more happy you are. And you can see that there is some correlation when you have very little energy, that you become happier as you have more. But once you have a certain amount of energy, the United States uses double the energy as the Netherlands and 38 times the energy as the Philippines, yet people are just as happy. So therein lies a seed of one way that we can go forward. Okay, the environment, most of you are environmental students, so you are aware of some of this stuff. What's the time? 1 o'clock, so I have 15 minutes, yeah? All right. So this is a climate change ensembles from IPCC. There's a lot of bad trajectories there in the future. My only comment here is that I don't think we have the affordable fossil fuels in the ground to reach the really bad scenarios, but there's all kinds of other positive feedbacks, positive in a negative way, that might arise. One interesting thing that came out in the July 2014 Science was a central finding of the latest report is that growth of income has been the largest single driver of emissions, looking at developed countries and such. That didn't make it into the summary for policymakers because it was too political. But if you think about what I said about energy, how it drives society, it's no wonder that income and wealth and GDP is incompatible with the reduction of emissions, in my opinion. Another point I feel kind of strongly about is all the scientific papers on climate change stop at 2100, as if climate change stops in the year 2100. We need a much, much longer plan to look at these things, and we should, I mean, once I die in 30 years, I don't care after that point, one day or 1,000 years after. I want things to go into the future with a livable biosphere. So humans are appropriating between 30 and 40% of the net primary productivity on the planet now. We're losing 100 species a day, we don't even know. We have dramatically impacted the natural world. I'm sure a lot of you saw the WWF report a week or two ago. You know, we're so focused on the human population moonshot in the last 10,000 years that we've kind of forgotten about this. 10,000 years ago, wild animals outnumbered humans by weight about 100 to 1 or more. We now outweigh them 50 to 1. Humans and our livestock outweigh wild animals 50 to 1. So no matter what your political sphere is, no matter if you believe climate change is real or urgent or not, this is indisputable. The fact that the human enterprise has taken over nature. And I think it's very profound. No, Canada's not as bad because you have a huge amount of land and not as many people, but globally this is a real problem. It makes me ask questions like, what's a beaver for? I've left the word A out. What is a beaver for? Well, it doesn't have to be for anything. It has its own life, it has its own ecosystems, and we view everything through an anthropocentric view lens that we have to have, that thing has to have value for us. Okay, synthesis. I know I'm throwing a lot at you, just try and kind of pick up a few things. So we turn energy and resources into dollars. We turn dollars into feelings, neurotransmitter feelings of Facebook or good food or whatever, plus waste. And whatever human ecosystem is developed in the future is going to be the same sort of thing. So we have to figure out how to get those feelings that our evolutionary ancestors had by using less stuff in the long run. So we basically have found this treasure trove of fossil carbon, which on all human timescales is indistinguishable from magic. It's becoming more costly for the energy companies to extract it, and people are less able to afford it, and that's the gauntlet that we're facing right now. Central banks are coming in and pumping this up, so we're not seeing the direct impacts as much. We're replacing, in the very short run, we're replacing high quality energy with money. You cannot create money, can't create energy with money, but you can extract what's out there faster. So I'm gonna skip that and that. So up until the 1970s, we lived more on an empty world, and we had physical world expansion, and we were using very high quality energy, and then we ran into a bump. And so the whole world went to debt as a model to pull resources forward in time from the 70s until the system crashed in 2007 and 2008. And then what happened is the central banks took over. The central banks and their sovereign guarantees and they're too big to fail and the artificially low interest rates and this whole spectrum of emergency measures has created this new stasis. And in order to keep our access to energy going, now countries are redefining GDP, redefining what we consider as growth. In Italy, cocaine sales and prostitution are now being added to GDP because otherwise the economy would look too bad. I don't know what's going to happen in the future. I know some things that probably won't happen in the future. But the way I view the world is a probability distribution. And every day I change my perceptions of what is most likely. I think anyone that tells you this is going to happen in the future, you should walk away because there's too many variables. You know, we could have 10 billion humans alive in 2050. I don't know. They won't be living like Americans, though. That I'm pretty sure about. So as energy gets more costly, what are the three or what are the two main things? Well, the main thing is that the lower two or three quintiles of society are going to have less and less because energy is so regressive and the poor people really need access to basic services. So we're going to have more and more poor people in Canada and in the US. In the United States, 95% of Americans have less take-home pay now than they did 10 years ago. Only the top 5% of Americans have more income after inflation than they did 10 years ago. So when we talk about the end of growth is here. We're living it. The other thing that's going to happen is the super energy intensive things are going to drop off because they're not economic. Cement manufacture, international air travel, those sort of things are using a lot of energy. One quick note on renewables, we're going to have to go to renewables 100% eventually. But the current narrative is let's just replace wind and solar and get rid of fossil fuels and continue consuming. And that's a misplaced narrative, I think, because more expensive fossil fuels and less expensive renewables, where they intersect is way above this hypothetical red line, which is where growth can continue. I'm going to skip that. Okay, conclusions. Money is a marker for energy and natural resources. For most people, growth is already over. There's no shortage of energy, but a longage of expectations. We have plenty of energy. Our bodies only need 3,000 calories a day, and the average American and Canadian use 230,000 calories. So we have a 90-to-1 buffer to design some benign future. Biology determines what we need. Culture determines how we get it. We're headed for a lower consumption, more local and regional future. We're still incredibly rich by historical standards. We use more energy, each of us, than kings and queens did a couple hundred years ago. Our predicament is not technical, but socio-political. Okay, there's a few professors in this room. Here are just some ideas to think about. We need more skills and knowledge applicable and relevant to a future with less stuff and more environmental constraints. We need detailed expertise and continued specialization, but perhaps the academy can stop rewarding hyper-specialization associated with reductionism, my own opinion. Develop a holistic awareness of our human relationship to the natural world and use that as a basic platform from which you work. Don't be afraid to have and defend an unpopular viewpoint. A highly educated, disciplined mind is a terrible thing to waste. And finally, just a random idea, perhaps new rules for tenure track or successful business people is to have some pro-social capstone when they're like 60 years old, that they give something back to the community or to the province or whatever. Okay, some suggestions for students in the room. Learn as much as you can and acquire knowledge, especially in natural sciences and about the brain as well. Start thinking at a young age in terms of real capital. Money is just a marker for the things in life that you really value and that are valuable to society. Observe, listen, experience, and then think for yourselves. We need technology, but not new gadgets. A lot of technology is like some new little toy that we play with for our brains, but it's not really powering civilization in a meaningful way forward. To transition to a more sustainable arrangement with the planet, this might equally come from the demand side as the supply side. How can we enjoy our lives and have meaningful existence without using a lot of throughput? Someone in the very near future has to wear the adult pants and look at our predicament using multiple lenses instead of just one, the profit lens, which everything is optimized on. Okay, key questions for young pro-social scientists. How do we create an accurate biophysical balance sheet of natural resource and sink capacities? How do we do the same thing for our human brain and evolved behavioral wiring? How do we balance human needs between current and future generations, between us and other species, between those alive today? 3 billion people live on like $2 a day right now. How do we implement pro-environmental policies as growth and wages and profits are declining, which is a real question? What do we aspire to as a species? Is this what we want, what we look outside today? What do we want the future to look like, and what are we willing to give up? Anything? So we're kind of at this long-term blip of fossil magic, and it's really hard to decide how to behave in that environment. And when I was your age, the young people in the room, I was getting the signal, go to Wall Street, make a lot of money, that's what's going to give you status. And I think that was the signal then. I think that the teams are changing now. And I think to have ecological knowledge and be working on all this stuff is actually a much more important and much cooler thing to do than to go and just make this money. Now, of course, we have an evolutionary drive for more, and it depends what our culture and our environment tell us is the cool thing to do, but I think we're headed in that direction. This is Bill Reese, who used to be in this building. I don't know if all of you know him, but he's one of my personal heroes and why I'm here today, but he couldn't make it. So there could be a great future in this place, different than we have today, but great. Let's get started. That's all I had. Time is 10 past. Oh, that I went really fast through that, so I'm sorry. So we have 10 minutes of questions. We have the room till 1:50, so there's actually 40 minutes for questions, but some of you might have to leave for another class. So questions, comments, things you disagree with, things you like, anything. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's actually a very important graph. Go on.
I'm just not clear how you came up with that graph. Like what kind of data were you?
That was a mathematical model, and all it did was this is the first time I've ever used that exact graph, so the fact that you have a question is good feedback. So tonight I have 207 slides. This was only 101. This one, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and this is what's so hard to understand, is that we're not replacing one unit of gasoline for one unit of human labor. One unit of gasoline already represents a whole lot of human labor. So as we go to more energy-intense processes that require lots of mechanical energy, okay, imagine this. Imagine that we had everyone in the woods with a chainsaw running around trying to chop down trees, and we had a truck for each person there to bring one log back. Well, no one would do that. Why? Because it would be way too expensive. We would be using 100,000 mechanical slaves to replace our one. So when we use 400, it's very, very energy intense. And when gasoline doubles in price, it's not doubling just, we don't just go to the tank and buy, okay, now it's $4 instead of two. It's $4 instead of two for all 400 of those units that are embedded in the system. So as energy prices go up, the really energy intensive processes are going to have a bigger haircut off of their profitability. So that's why this used to be more profitable, and now this, which is less energy intensive, turns out to be more profitable in that new environment. Okay, good question. Does that make sense a little? Yeah, I will send some documentation on these things to Justin or Bonnie, and efficiency cannot overcome a doubling or tripling in price. It could have a 20 or 30%. The real price?
Yeah, real
price. Well, you can't pick one of the years that it was at its peak.
No, I'm picking the price today, which is $84 versus 1971 when it was peak. Now, you can correct for inflation, but you don't think that that is a doubling of price?
Yeah, it is. And we had a lot of efficiency improvements from the 70s on. In the long run, if we have more and more expensive energy, efficiency can overcome 20 or 30 or 40% of it, but it can't overcome all of it.
But the actual spectrum loss efficiency in a modern industrial climate for the amount of useful energy per unit of total energy is about equal. So where do you get that's a factor of 10, not a factor of 30.
If you improve the efficiency of a power plant or something like that, those over the last 30 or 40 years have improved 30%.
Right.
I'm just saying is that as
in
power plants we're approaching theoretical limits of efficiency. Okay. And all the tasks that led up to it with the roads and the airplanes and the transport and everything.
The whole chain of programs.
So what is your recommendation?
Well, but there's just your line showing GDP and energy use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree there's a bit more potential. I'm not talking about the next 3 years. I'm kind of the longer term landscape is.
It's way more than that, right? It's way more than that. You should, for example, you're giving the example of converting primary energy to electricity.
Well, no, most of my argument has to do with liquid fuels. Electricity is you know, only 30 or 40%.
30% efficiency gain that you're talking
about. Yeah, well, that was one example.
It's only in the electrical thermal energy to electricity conversion.
Right.
Nothing like that. We were about 70% efficient, and we're now at about 80% efficient. Our efficiency in fuel cells is completely different to that. So all I'm saying is, it's not as simple as you just described on the primary to secondary energy forms, and it's certainly nowhere near as small a margin in the end-use conversion services. So take lighting as an example, right? Incandescent lights, 95% heat, 5% light. LED lights, 5% heat, 95% light. So all the difference in the energy can be converted into light. And you can change the price of the energy dramatically. You can make it 10 times higher. But the price of a function that is facilitated through light hasn't changed.
Most of my argument is to deal with the oil side and the fact that our transportation systems are heavily dependent on liquid fuels and growth. And I didn't really get into the financial overhang of printing money in order to maintain our trajectory. So it's not an issue so much of efficiency, like you're saying?
Let's go to oil. I don't have a problem with talking about oil specifically.
Okay.
Not oil, but liquid transportation fuel.
Yeah.
Okay? What price did you go up to, you said? $120, right?
Yeah.
$130 a barrel. What do you think the price of coal conversion to electric fuel is?
You mean Fischer Tropsch?
There are lots of, but essentially we can talk about what the group, what the South Africans have been doing since about 1950, and what in World War II the Germans were doing because they didn't have access to water. So what do you think the price of that is? If I was to convert coal to coal reserves into a liquid fuel that is a direct substitute for transportation, what do you think the cost of that is?
The true cost, including climate impacts, or the dollar cost?
Well, because you were showing investment cost using a
right. So it's I don't know, $80, $100, somewhere like that.
60.
Okay, 60 to generate 80 million barrels. I mean, do we really want to do that?
It's not a question of whether we want to do it. If it's an economic imperative, that's the question you should ask.
That's one of the questions.
Yeah. The point is, you're saying the motivation of the investor is now at a marginal $120 a barrel
for the oil majors.
For the oil majors?
Yeah.
Well,
that's a Goldman Sachs report.
I'm just saying to you, if they can make liquid transportation fuel for $60 in the long run, why are they spending $120 in oil and gas? Can you answer that question?
One would be the climate impacts, and they're concerned about that. Another would be the flow rate. How much capital do you need? They're finding oil they can get out in 2 years. A Fischer Tropsch thing, I mean, how long would that take? I don't know is the answer.
Fine.
Okay.
But what else, you know,
students, anyone else? I assume you're a professor, by the way, of... I have a whole paper on it that we wrote for the UK government. I can send it to you.
Okay. Because the price of electricity in Vermont is 17.6 cents per kilowatt hour.
Yeah.
And I just worked it out that you'd be running at a loss.
At what?
At being able to give, I mean, I've got the price of milk, inputs to production, and the price of electricity. In the right hand side column, you'd be running at a loss at 700 kilowatt hour.
I'll show you the whole model. I don't want to get into it now, but we have the model. In a 60-page paper, so I'm happy to send it to you. More general questions. You, sir, in the back. But we don't care about the long term usually. We care about what are we going to do now. If we have a liquid fuel problem, we'll turn coal into liquid and worry about the other things later. You know, we don't, that's part of my own philosophical view, is we have no 50 or 100 year plan. It's everything like right now. And we're creating a larger and larger human heat engine that needs more primary energy inputs without thinking about the deeper future. Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, what you're getting at is Jevons' paradox, that there's a rebound effect, that if we get more efficient and save energy here, someone in China is going to build 10 more square feet of cement or something like that. Is that really the trajectory we want to go? More questions?
questions, especially from those people that have frowns on their faces. Those people now have smiles. I mean, this is a lot. It's, you know, I've spent the last 12 years, 40 hours a week, reading and researching all these things. And I'm most interested in human behavior because I think we have to overcome, we're never going to overcome it. We have to embrace it and understand it if we're going to have some new narrative. And, you know, energy is very important, but why we use energy is a really critical question. All right, great. Thank you. Do you know Justin? I can send him the paper, or
Justin,
I just...
Justin is one of my graduates.
Oh, he is? Okay, I'll send him the paper.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Nice to
you. You too. Yeah. Yeah. Well, there was one that had actual numbers and one that was hypothetical. Oh, wait. This one?
Yeah.
Well, this is a hypothetical curve. It's just saying that our culture and our